You know, as believers, we will face opposition. You know, whether it's family members who oppose our faith or disagree, who might be atheistic, agnostic, or who knows, an educational system that undermines the faith in God, or politicians who might disdain it, persecutions for sharing it. Jesus told us in this world we would have trouble. And I think we see the troubles in so many ways, particularly against the faith of what we believe in Christ.
Abounding in Faith is the broadcast ministry of Emmanuel Bible Church of Howell, New Jersey. If you are blessed by this message, please subscribe to our podcast or YouTube channel. You can also download our app by searching for IBCNJ in the Google Play Store or the Apple Store. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org. Our speaker today is Senior Pastor Joe Suozzo.
We're in the book of Genesis, so if you have your Bibles with you, I encourage you to turn there to chapter 1. And this is our second week, and what have we been saying is that these chapters perhaps are the most important chapters in terms of the foundation of our faith and our ability to trust God's word. And so it's incumbent upon me as your pastor to help you understand that these chapters of Genesis are not contradictory to science, but rather there are some really good things to be discovered. It's necessary for us to have a confidence in the way the world began, because we no doubt in this world have two large competing ideas about the way things started. That things start at a fate and chance, an explosion without any necessarily purpose or reason, or is there a God, Genesis 1:1, who we so unashamedly declares in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Those are our two positions. And it's important for us to have a sense of confidence as we journey in this world as believers in Christ. You know, as believers, we will face opposition. You know, whether it's family members who oppose our faith or disagree, who might be atheistic, agnostic, or who knows, an educational system that undermines the faith in God, or politicians who might disdain it, persecutions for sharing it. Jesus told us in this world we would have trouble. And I think we see the troubles in so many ways, particularly against the faith of what we believe in Christ. Paul wrote to Timothy that those who live godly lives will be persecuted. You will not be a friend of the world to make a declaration that you are a follower of God and Christ. You know, and for us to be effective as believers in this world, we need to be able to give reasons for the hope that's in us. You know, when we talk about the hope that's in us, what we're saying is that as followers of the person of Jesus Christ, we are now reconciled to God. God sent his only begotten Son, Jesus, that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have everlasting life. We believe that. We gather to celebrate it. And because we believe it, it's incumbent upon us as we share it with others that I have a hope that extends forever and ever. People do not have that hope. We see that in the world. We saw this through this season of COVID, the terror, the fear of losing one's life. But the good news is that, not that we shouldn't try to do the best we can with what we have, but even if we lose what we have in Christ, we have eternal life. That's the good news of the gospel. 1 Peter 3:15, we're encouraged this way in our hearts to set apart Christ as Lord. And listen to this, always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks us for the reason for the hope that's in us. And the idea here is for reason is apologia, or to give an apologetic. The idea is that when I'm with others and I'm walking with Christ and the conversation goes in that direction, and it will and it should at times, that I'm capable of talking about my faith. And I can tell you right now, one of the key questions that comes up again and again is, how did the world begin? And can the Bible be trusted as God's word? And of course, I'm here to tell you it can. When we lack the ability to give answers, then the gospel often cannot find its full expression from our hearts to others. And I see this obstacle within our culture, this lie that things began in some kind of unknown way. Well, here we have a declaration, Genesis. Did it begin? The question is, with a big bang, billions of years ago, followed by evolutionary process? Or is there a God who's all-powerful, eternal, and brought everything into existence? That's really the two postulates, or the two thoughts that are before us in modern world today. Now, I believe we're on the winning side of the argument. I do, for many reasons, and so we're going to get into some discussion. Maybe it's going to be a little heady at times, but I think it's valuable for us, because I think it's important for you to feel secure that when you pick up this book, The Gift of Life, that is truth, that we have confidence from its beginning, chapter 1 of Genesis, verse 1, all the way through to Revelation, which gives an account of Christ's return. You know, in National Geographic, just to show you how hostile sometimes this world is to it, to the gospel, there was a issue a few years ago with this: was Darwin wrong? And so when you turn to the page of the article, this is the way it starts. Was Darwin wrong? No, no. Then the next line is, the evidence of evolution is overwhelming. And the magazine lays out arguments, quoting scholars from various universities and Ivy League schools, dismissing the Bible believing Christians as unscientific and absurd. At one point, the article tells us that 56% of America's public still does not believe in evolution. Their explanation is because biblical creationists, that's people like me, and evangelicals are ignorant and interfere in the public schools. By the way, this is National Geographic. So I feel like I could respond to that. It is a condescending article that was simply designed to discredit the Bible's account of creation. PBS, tax-funded PBS, your tax dollars hard at work, aired a multi-week series around the same time called Evolution. It's a multi-million dollar production funded by just left-leaning businessmen like Paul Allen, co-founder of Microsoft. They went all out to produce a series, a spectacular series, all the bells and whistles that modern media can afford. What was the opening scene? Well, opening scene, Darwin is making his famous journey on the HMS Beagle, and Darwin and the captain of the ship, Robert Fitzroy, is arriving in a village in South Africa where the natives lead them to a skull of an extinct sloth. Darwin asked Fitzroy, the captain, I wonder where these creatures, why they no longer exist. Fitzroy answers, perhaps the ark, Noah's ark, was too small to allow them to enter, and they perished in the flood. Darwin laughs and mockingly, with a mocking tone, says to Fitzroy, or Fitzroy says to Darwin, what's there to laugh at here? And he says, nothing, Darwin responds. Then Fitzroy asks us, do you mock me or the Bible? And Darwin says unapologetically, neither. Then the next scene has Fitzroy reading from Genesis 1 with Darwin below deck mockingly rolling his eyes. That's the opening scene. So make no mistake about it. These chapters have come under assault in the modern world, and it's important for us to have a sense of why it's important that we trust them. And so for the next few weeks, I'm going to give you reasons, I think, that are important for all of us. I do this every 10 years or so in this church. We go through these chapters. Why are the stakes so high? Remember last week we talked about the importance of God's word in our lives. You know, if you take away the Bible, its credibility, then the question is, what is the source of truth for our lives? Maybe it's you. Maybe it's you. Maybe it's you. No one knows. Therefore, truth becomes subjective and unknown. And you wind up raising a generation of cynics and skeptics. And that's exactly where we are as a culture. If you can raise truth over the Bible and its veracity, then you can raise doubt over the ability to know truth. And if you can raise doubt over our ability to know truth, then you basically discredit every truth claim. And if every truth claim is dismissed, then the Bible and the gospel becomes one more philosophy and religion out of a bunch of different ideas. You choose, you choose, you choose. Either God has spoken and said this way, or he hasn't. I'm of the belief he spoke. And he said, yeah, there is a way, there's a truth, and there's a life. And you know, the good news, despite all the millions of dollars that are spent to discredit these chapters, Christianity is exploding in many parts of the world. And evolution as a science is in a state of collapse. I'm talking about amongst scientists who don't even believe in God. There's so many contradictions within it. We're just going to talk about a few this morning, that it's not even a difficult argument to make anymore. You know, there's just one more example before we read the Word of God together. This is an article about Anthony Flew, who in academic circles was the most prominent atheist of the 20th century. How would you like that name? I am the most prominent atheist of the 20th century, right? What a title, right? Anthony Flew. He was the signer of the Second Humanist Manifesto, honorary professor at Oxford, considered one of the most brilliant minds of philosophy of the century. And so in 2004, he turned from atheism to belief in God. His age, 81. What changed this man's mind? Listen. According to Flew, quote unquote, since the beginning of my philosophical life, I have followed the policy of Plato's Socrates. We must follow the argument wherever it leads. It was intelligent design theory, the idea that God created the heavens and the earth, that turned his heart to what is true. You know, in Oxford, at the Scientific Academy, where Isaac Newton, a great scientist over the centuries, passed through in Oxford University, which was founded on Christian principles, in stone, and I'm glad they put these things in stone, is Psalm 111:2. Great are the works of the Lord. They're studied by all who delight in them. It's still there if you walk through. So open your Bibles if you have them, or take a pew Bible. This one's an easy chapter to find. It's the first one. And stand with me, and we're going to read the first 8 verses of Genesis. In the beginning, Genesis 1:1, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness, and God called the light day, and the darkness he called night, and there was evening, and there was morning the first day. And then God said, let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters. And God made the expanse and separated the waters, and there was an expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so, and God called the expanse heaven, and there was evening, and there was morning the second day. Father, we just pray as we look at a few of these verses together, our hearts would be encouraged by who you are. The amazing God who brought all things into existence. And more than that, you love us with an everlasting love, expressed so perfectly in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Christ's name, amen. Well, you may be seated again. Last week we looked at verse 1. God created the heavens and the earth, and we talked about God in his nature was without beginning, if you remember. That's called the eternality of God. Very important concept. God's also all-powerful. How much power does he have, Jeff Cantor?
Unlimited.
Unlimited power. There you go. There's a resident theologian on pew two. Is he able to do all things? It's a contradictory statement to see that God is limited in what he can accomplish. That's good news, right? I don't know where you're at this morning, but there's an application right there. I don't know where you're at, what problem you're facing, but he's able to do immeasurably more than we ask or think, Scripture teaches. So we come to before the first day in verse 2, and it tells us it's formless and dark. What's really going on here? These are thoughts not from your pastor. I was reading a lot of different people's ideas on this, scientists and theologians. And after reading, the best way to translate verse 2 is that the earth and the waters, before there was form, were non-spherical. In other words, God created stuff before he brought order into the universe. Before the 6 days of creation, God created matter to begin to shape it and with his own purposes and design. In Isaiah 45:18, we find something that kind of reflects that sentiment, where it says, God did not create the earth to be empty, but formed it to be inhabited. Henry Morris, who's the co-founder of Creation Research Institute, paraphrases this verse this way: God created the earth with purpose to not be formless and empty or uninhabited. Right from the beginning, we find that God is imbuing into creation a sense of purpose that extends to us. I don't know where you're at in life, but I was sharing this, that the greatest problem with the generation coming up, the Z's and the millennial generation, is a sense of purposelessness. You cannot have meaning and purpose apart from God, who's the one who created us to have meaning and purpose. He designed space, matter, time to bring design and life and form into it. And one of the fundamental truths of the Bible is that the world and man were created for a purpose. You know, I was reading this a few years ago. I love this. George Washington Carver, an African-American scientist of the 19th century, we've all probably heard about him, the one who found many uses for the peanut. I was reading an excerpt from his diary, which I thought was interesting. He called his laboratory, by the way, God's little workshop. Very humble man. According to his own account, it was there in prayer he asked God to show him the purposes of the lowly crop, the peanut. Dear Mr. Creator, the humble man asked, please tell me what the universe was made for. God replies, ask for something more in keeping with that little mind of yours. God answered, so Carver tried again. Dear Mr. Creator, what was man-made for. Again, the Lord replied, little man, you ask too much. Cut down the extent of your request and improve the intent. So the scientist tried once more. Then, Mr. Creator, will you tell me what the peanut was made for? That's better, the Lord said. And beginning that day, Carver discovered over 300 uses for the lowly peanut. I like that. A peanut has purpose. A peanut. I want you to think about that. And this humble man of God discovered all these purposes for a peanut that are still used today in so many ways, even in manufacturing and foods and so many places. God is a God of purpose, and we should be encouraged by that, that as we follow him, we're going to discover purpose for our lives. But if you look at verse 2, going back again, we not only see that God is now taking this indescript, formless, dark matter and ready to bring purpose to it, but we also see a continued theme of the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and it's right there from the beginning of Scripture. Genesis 1:2, we see the Spirit hovering, which literally means to vibrate. The Spirit's ready to do the Father's bidding. In verses 1 and 2, verse 1, remember last week we talked about Elohim, which is the plural word for the word God. And so here we see that the Father, the Son, are ready to bring creation with the Spirit. And we see that in John's Gospel, chapter 1, verse 1. All things were created by him and for him. There was nothing that was created that wasn't created without him. That's Christ. And then we saw in Colossians last week that all things were created by him, visible and invisible. And so we see the Spirit of God, who's resident, ready to move on the creation process on behalf of the Godhead. And then we come to this first day. The first day, verse 3. And God said, let there be light. Wow. You know, who would argue that light is not the most important thing that we really need? For everything, really. You know, just as an exercise, everyone close their eyes. And a person who's born handicapped or loses their eyesight is an incredible disability, is it not? You can open them now. The Lord said, let there be light. It's a gift. It's a gift. Now, I want to talk about something here. The first thing I want to really help us see that when God's speaking about these first 6 days of creation, he's talking about literal 24-hour periods of time. You know, I reject completely the idea that God inserted millions of years into this process. Some people try to do that and try to fit evolution and a big bang somehow into the evolutionary process into this, but it really doesn't work, because throughout the Bible, the word for day here, which is yom in the Hebrew, is used always the same way, 24 hours. You don't find a deviation from that. It's always the same. You can't reconcile a bankrupt position of evolution with creation, but there are some who try to do that. One way they try to do is what is called the gap theory. This is for you nerds, if you want to take notes, who like to have these kinds of things. But the gap theory is the idea that in verse 2, when the earth was without form and there was darkness, that somehow that's where the billions of years are. Well, the problem is remember last week we said that without mass and matter and without the rotation of planets, you really don't know what time is, because time is just, we only know a day is because the earth spins on its axis. We only know what a month is because the moon goes around the earth. We only know what a year is by the earth going around the sun. You take those things away, then you have no time. And we were talking about that God is beyond the dimension of time. That doesn't start till day 4. And so there's no need to insert. First of all, and is God able? Yes. A second way people try to reconcile evolutionary theory is what's called the day-age theory, where they import millions of years into each day. Each day represents an evolutionary process, but these are filled with all kinds of inconsistencies. I mean, first is, when we speak of God as all-powerful, who spoke and was able to bring something out of nothing, could he not work anything out in a 24-hour period of time? I hope you say yes. Listen to what Psalm 33:6 tells us. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, by the word of his mouth their starry hosts. He spoke, he came to be, he commanded, it stood firm. And of course, Psalm 24:1, the earth is the Lord's and everything in it. God did not need to insert billions of years. And by the way, it creates all kinds of logical absurdities when you do that. For example, in Genesis, now we're talking about, when exactly did human civilization begin? If evolution is true and man came from a monkey, and yet we're supposed to be created in God's image, when did a monkey become man? And who was the first man? And if we do not believe that the first man, according to Genesis, is Adam, how did sin and death enter into the world? So the logical absurdities just go on and on and on. And it doesn't work. And so God, in one day, said, let there be light. Now, look at verse 3 again, and he says this. God saw the light was good, and he declared it evening and morning that first day. Now, I'm going to ask you a question. This is for your science buffs. What is light? Energy. What? Vibration. Is it a particle or a wave? Both. Or you don't know? Well, here's the thing. When you observe it, it shows the properties of a wave, shows the properties of a particle, but the scientists can't commit. And there are certain mysteries going on here that the science can say, well, I can observe it and it does this and it does that, but I can't tell you what this stuff is. It's indescribable, but we know it exists, you see. We know that it is the most precious commodity of life, and you know, it is one of the most used metaphors in the Bible. When we speak of salvation in Christ, for example, we're turning from what? Darkness to light. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul put it this way, God who spoke, let there be light, has shown in our hearts through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so many other places. Jesus Christ is called the light of the world. Those who reject him continue to walk in darkness, but those who believe on him would not walk in darkness but have everlasting life. And so many other metaphors are there in Scripture. And so we have the first day light. The second day, if you look at verse 6 through 9, 8 rather, the second day we see God creates the atmosphere that separates the earth from the skies above. God said, let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters. And God made the expanse and separated the water. What is going on here? A number of creationists have said on day one, while the universe was brilliant with light, God literally stretched out space on day two. In other words, God provided the framework for the rest of his created work. Like an artist getting ready to put down paint, or a sculptor with his marble or clay. Think about it. First thing an artist does, who's painting, does what? Puts out the easel with the blank canvas. You know, it's interesting, when Michelangelo sculpted the famous statue David, he would stand before this piece of marble which had flaws in it. No one wanted to do anything with it. For weeks he studied this blank piece of marble before he put the hammer and the first strike to it to bring form to it. You know, at this juncture, I just want us to talk about, kind of like as a parenthetical remark, five problems with the Big Bang. We've been taught since we were kids that the Earth started, or the world started, the universe started with a Big Bang. Let's talk about five problems with the Big Bang, just to help you out, if you're taking notes. First problem with the Big Bang is that it's not exactly science. National Center for Science Education has long taught that science is empirically based. What does that mean, empirically based? In other words, only what we can observe can be deemed fact. Everything else is theories and assumptions. The theory developed by Edwin Hubble, based on a discovery that light, the universe is expanding, they extrapolated that idea and brought it back. They said, well, the universe must have started somewhere, so it started with a Big Bang. But who was there 14 billion years ago? Were you there? Were you there? So it's a theory based on an assumption. No one was there. So it truly isn't science. It's a theory. Second problem with Big Bang is this. Explosions do not create order. How do I know that? When I was a 10-year-old kid, you could still get ash cans. Who remembers the ash can and the cherry bombs? And the M80s. Oh, how I still have 10 digits is a miracle from on high. These were like quarter sticks of dynamite, half stick of dynamite, and an eighth sticks of dynamite that 10-year-old kids could get in grocery stores. What was the problem of our generation? Why are we still here? What's the purpose of life? No. And, you know, we would go to neighbors' trash cans and throw in a ash can, which is like an eighth of a stick of a dynamite, and light it and run away and watch from a distance and watch the thing blow up and trash all over the place, and magically a beautiful sculpture came out. No, I'm joking. Explosions don't create design, period. And the intricacies, which we're going to talk about the next few weeks, of cell life and DNA and so many laws of physics, how gravity holds us together and holds everything together. Explosions don't create that. Third problem with Big Bang is what is called the fine-tuning principle. Well, I was talking to, I think, a young lady about this a few days ago. Stephen Myers, a professor at astrophysics at Cambridge, and a believer, describes the problem of the Big Bang as irreducible complexity. And what does that mean? Irreducible complexity is the idea that if something appears to be complex with design, then it is complex with design. Explosions don't create that. Let's just take an example. This is from him. A mousetrap. How many pieces does a mousetrap have? 5 pieces. How many moving pieces? 2. Right? With a spring. To look at that mousetrap and say an explosion created that would be an absurd conclusion. And that's just a mousetrap. The human body, or the eye, or anything you would look at, and you see design and beauty and all of it. And it all begs the question, from where did it come from? And we have the answer as believers in Christ. It comes from an almighty God who loves you. I like what Isaac Newton, who gave us the theory of gravity, and a believer, 18th century, he said this: the most beautiful system of sun, planets, comets could only proceed from the counsel and dominion of an intelligent, powerful being. I love that. Fourth problem of Big Bang is the question of what's called causality. Causality is the idea that everything that we know has to have a first cause. We look at the world around us and no one says that came from nothing. We always go back in our minds to where it came from. And so the idea that matter had eternality attached to it doesn't make sense to anyone. And so that's called the argument of first cause. There has to be a first cause. And we say God, who is spirit, brought matter into being. Matter didn't always exist. And then this final, last thing is that if we embrace the Big Bang, and then we have to dismiss the Genesis narrative that God created the universe and the earth is young, not old. Listen to what Romans chapter 21 tells us. Listen to these verses. For although they knew God, this is the scientific community now, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him. But what did they do? They became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images and creation itself. I think that the rejection of God and to embrace this system of what is called materialism and scientific atheistic material is one of the foolish, most foolish things man has done. And we look at a generation coming up who's being brainwashed with this kind of stuff, and we wonder why depression and anxiety is at its highest. We wonder why that, and I was sharing this last week, that 46% of Harvard's class is saying that they're deeply depressed. These are the smartest minds in the country. We wonder why that suicide is increasing amongst teenagers and even younger than that, and we see the state of our culture. Well, you remove God out of the formula of life, and you stop teaching it, and you wonder, where is your purpose coming from? And it's ultimately says, the answer is, you are to discover your own purpose. And so you have young people with this heavy, unbearable load that's too heavy to carry, and they're walking around trying to figure out life on their own, and yet God is there. That I would give you purpose if you ask. I'd like to just finish up with describing a scene from a movie I saw a few years ago. I don't know how many saw this. Joe versus the volcano. I liked it because my name is Joe. Tom Hanks plays Joe, a young man who discovers he's only 6 months to live due to a rare brain disease, and he accepts an offer from an eccentric billionaire who wants the mineral rights of a small island in the South Pacific. In exchange for all the money he can spend for this period of time, Joe agrees to sacrifice himself by jumping into the island's active volcano in order to appease the island people's gods. It's a really weird movie. Scene begins with Joe and his friend Patricia, played by Meg Ryan, floating on four large pieces of luggage that are tied together. Their boat sank in a storm while they were on the way to the island. Patricia's unconscious, Joe's weak due to hunger and thirst. Day turns to night and Joe stares into the surrounding darkness. Suddenly, the top of the edge of the giant horizon is glowing red, and the sun begins to rise in front of him, or the moon rather. And it's so close he can almost touch it. Wobbly leg, Joe slowly stands up. Soon the full-sized brilliant moon is directly in front of him, is stunning, breathtaking beauty, and Joe's silhouetted in front of it and raises both his hands over his head. His face has a look of complete awe and reverence. As the moon continues to rise, Joe sinks back to his knees and puts his hands towards his chest, and he says in a fearful, reverent tone, "Dear God, whose name I do not know, thank you for my life. I forgot how big. Thank you. Thank you for my life." He's speechless. He faints. Maybe you're here this morning, and like Joe heading towards a meaningless death on some volcanic island, you would also pray, "Dear God, whose name I do not know." I have good news for you. God, who created the heavens and the earth, spoke everything into existence, wants you to know him, to come into relationship with him through the person of Jesus Christ. That's why Jesus came. Listen to how Paul says it again. For God, who said, "Let light shine out of darkness," has made his light shine in our hearts to give us what? The light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. Jesus is the one who opened the way. That's why he came. He came to die for our sins. And that when we trust him, not only are we forgiven, but we are now given the promises of eternal life. Given the promise that God's purposes would be worked out in us. He gives us what we don't have. The purpose and the meaning that we're looking for. Maybe you're here this morning, you're praying, God, I want to know you, but I don't. I'm telling you, the way you can know Christ begins with Jesus, who said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." Let's pray. Father, thank you for these verses of Genesis and the challenge they are to our hearts. And Lord, I pray that as we continue on with this day, we'd be shaken by the realities of the truth that you've created the heavens and the earth, not to be formless and empty, but filled with light and beauty. And you created us in your image to know you, to be filled with the things of God, and to have joy, to have a sense of love of who you are and for others, and to be filled with all the goodness of God. I pray that we would leave encouraged by those thoughts. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.